ones they have. And I highly recommend Mardi Gras to anybody, not the college kid French Quarter version of Mardi Gras, but where the real family's out and people are having a good time. Since I've moved back, I've really come to understand its special sort of connection to people here and what a great local event it is.
Dear, I had to laugh when James Carville said Mardi Gras is a family activity because I've been to Mardi Gras. It is an overload of libation and, you know, women throwing their tops up and what have you. I did not realize that there was another activity other than the French Quarter college scene Mardi Gras that he described.
Well, I'm sure you enjoyed the revelry of your Mardi Gras experiences, but again, as someone who's there from New Orleans, it really is much bigger than just a revelry, apparently, which is lost on many people.
But he's right, and I forgot about the Mardi Gras Indians, the parade, and I would like to actually go back to New Orleans and experience the real Mardi Gras, the daytime Mardi Gras, and get out of the French Quarter and all of the debauchery that goes on in the evening. I mean, it really is an overload of the senses and activities, and it's for a youthful person.
Well, hopefully we can handle that at this point in our lives.
We'll see.
As we wrap up here, I wanted to touch briefly on how you and Mary have really opened your home to kind of help a lot of the nonprofits and a lot of these causes in New Orleans, whether it's one of the organizations like Friends of New Orleans or some of the local colleges and universities such as Dillard and even Tulane. You guys really have made New Orleans a big part of who you are, and a lot of the things that you're working on as an individual kind of really speak to some of the larger challenges that we as a nation need to tackle. How is this passion of service for you and for Mary being manifested each and every day as you're down there in New Orleans?
I think that we subconsciously, and we keep saying, we're going to have a dinner party that doesn't have a purpose. And we keep promising ourselves we're going to do it. We've just never gotten around to get it done yet, because most all of the entertainment we do is purpose-driven, and we like that. Don't get me wrong. People here like to have a good time, but like to have fun while doing good, you know? And we're glad we're able to have a house that is conducive to entertaining. We bought it with that in mind. It's one of the reasons that we bought the house we did. And we enjoy having, one day we'll have Ideal. We'll have Ideas Village. We'll have a Teach for America thing. We'll have a thing for Dillard or Cafe Reconcile, you name it. And we enjoy that, and we had President Clinton over for a fundraiser for Terry McAuliffe. It's always fun to have an ex-president in your house, and Mary's done, we've had Speaker Boehner in the house. She's done Republican events here, too. We do a lot of that, and I'm working on a new project here that I'm getting very excited about. It's going to take a little while to bring to fruition, but I think we do. It's going to be a big, big boost for our culture. So it's there's always something going on here. There's always an event, something happening.
Well, James, we're going to have to bring you back some other time to talk about that new project. And
absolutely,
it's been a pleasure.
And it's going to be you will love this new project. I'm just going to keep it under wraps here but it's not going to be under wraps for very long.
Do we get an exclusive?
I'm some version of it. I don't know, but you'll certainly get a lot of interviews. But it'll be something very, 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 very significant. On a coach, the event in our coach.
Awesome.
Okay, and we'll talk about it.
All right, James Carville, we thank you so much for being with us today on World Footprints.
Love being on the show.
I am here with Luis Villaseñor of the Puerto Vallarta Tourism Board. Luis, welcome to World Footprints. In writing the first chapter of our Puerto Vallarta story, what would that be? What would that sound like?
Well, when you come to Mexico, you need to experience the food. the tequila, the mariachi, and the charro culture. So without question, when you come to Puerto Vallarta, you have the chance to experience all of this because this is the homeland of that. So basically, what it is, Puerto Vallarta is a charming Mexican traditional town with the facilities of a mother city anywhere in the world, with tons of over 25,000 rooms, over 300 different restaurants, and tons of activities. So when people come to our city, they have the chance at an outstanding holiday. So either they come in with the family, with for a bachelor party, or for a honeymoon, a wedding, and just a getaway from any of the big cities close to the state. They just want to spend a nice weekend. Well, Puerto Vallarta has something to offer to all kind of budgets, all kind of expectations.
The Rue de Martyrs offers a glimpse into Paris life as it has been for centuries. The quaint half-mile stretch of land is secluded from tourists, yet the myths and legacies of the Rue de Martyrs would beckon any traveler seeking an authentic Parisian experience. Author and former New York Times Paris bureau chief Elaine Chalino has called the Rue de Martyrs home for over a decade. In her new book, The Only Street in Paris, she brings to life the history and the daily life of its longtime and colorful residents. It is there that Saint Denis, the patron saint of France, was beheaded, and where Degas and Renoir created. The Rue de Martyrs is where the Jesuits took their first vows and where longtime residents know your name. Elaine, welcome to World Footprints.
Oh, thanks. I've never done your show before, and it's a real pleasure and an honor.
Well, we love travelers. We love talking to expats, and we'll find out a little bit more about your life as an American expat in Paris. But we're quite curious, out of all of the streets in Paris, and there's so many, why did the Rue des Martyrs capture your attention?
Because it's magic. One of the people I interviewed said to me, the Rue des Martyrs is the center of the universe. It's a street where anybody can feel comfortable. You know how people go to Paris and they sometimes say, oh, the French, they're so difficult, or people were rude, or they don't smile on the street.
Mm-hmm.
I was able to make the Rue des Martyrs mine. And I was able, over the time that we've lived on that side of the river, to get to know the people on the street, get to know their, obviously, their produce, their cheeses, their charcuterie, their clothing in the clothing boutiques, their what we call their métier, their professions, if they're artisans, but also to get to know their lives. And it doesn't happen often in life that you can, in a very compressed community, get to really know people. And, you know, I'm a journalist and curious and can talk to anybody about anything. So I just became part of the community in a wonderful way.
Now, why is the street named as such? Why is it named the Rue des Martyrs, or the Street of Martyrs?
In the 3rd century, Saint Denis, or Saint Denis, was a preacher. He was preaching the Christian gospel, and he was doing so well that the pagans, the Roman pagans, took him and two of his companions up the Rue des Martyrs and beheaded them. And for those of your listeners who are Catholic, they might remember that Saint Denis became a martyr because he died for the faith, but then he carried his head several miles to the north, and then he, as always happens with martyrs, he finally died and dropped his head, and that's where they built the big Saint Denis Basilica. But the street on which this beheading, according to legend, of course, took place was the Rue des Martyrs, or the Street of Martyrs. And Saint Denis is the patron saint of France now.
Right, right.
Now, I know this street has an amazing heritage from a cultural perspective in France, with names such as Degas, Renoir, Puccini, and a whole host of others. What attracted all of these creative types to this street?
The right bank of the Seine, you know, the France, Paris is divided into the left bank and the right bank. The right bank in the 19th century became a sort of headquarters for artists and writers. And so you had people like artists like Degas and Renoir painting circus scenes, because there was a very famous circus on the Rue des Martyrs. When the Picasso Museum reopened recently, among Picasso's memorabilia were found little ticket stubs because he had gone to this circus. Toulouse-Lautrec painted there. And you had people like Baudelaire, the poet Baudelaire, who frequented a very famous brasserie, a famous bar, nightclub place. And in our time, if you can believe it, Pharrell Williams and Kanye West recorded songs in a state-of-the-art studio that is on the Rue des Martyrs.
You're listening to World Footprints Radio with Tanya and Ian Fitzpatrick. We're talking to author and New York Times writer Elaine Cholino about her new book, The Only Street in Paris, Life on the Rue des Martyrs. Elaine says that the half-mile stretch of this street is magical, and walking along the Rue des Martyrs is always a joyous experience.
Now, in researching the history of Rue des Martyrs, was there one historical story that stood out that had some special appeal for you?
I'm glad you asked that question, Ian. Yes. In 1534, on the Feast of the Assumption, August 15th, 1534, Ignatius Loyola and six of his companions went to the site of where Saint-Denis was beheaded and took their first vows before they created the Jesuit order. And for me, that was very important because I went to a Jesuit college as an undergraduate. I went to Canisius College in Buffalo, New York. My father had gone there. I was married by a Jesuit priest and a rabbi, and I covered the Vatican and traveled with the Pope. You know, I was very close to the Jesuits. And there's a crypt there that's this very small, unknown crypt. There's no, you know, Saint-Denis gift shop across the street or St. Ignatius Loyola tapas bar. But I took it upon myself to write to Pope Francis and ask him to come to the Rue des Martyrs. And I told him I had covered the Vatican years ago. I told him that I'm in the Volunteer Association of the Crypt. I told him my middle name is Francis. And I said, look, someday you have to come to France because France is the eldest daughter of the church because of its history with the Catholic Church. And when you come, I want you to come to my street. I'm still waiting for the response. He has not called me back. So if your listeners have any in with Pope Francis, please ask Pope Francis to pick up his phone and call me on my cell phone. I left my cell phone number in the letter.
Well, you should have come to D.C. and or New York when he was here recently and caught up with him there.
You know, the book was like 2 days away from being published because I was poised to get that book with somebody, one of my colleagues who's on the plane today, covers the Vatican today, to take it back to Rome. So we're going to have to, I think we might have to have a little bit of divine intervention, Tanya, now.
We can work on that. We'll work on that with you.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that. Yes.
Now, you know, Ian and I are former travel agency owners. We're obviously travel journalists, and we've traveled the world. We've used numerous resources, and I'm shocked. We're both shocked that the Rue des Martyrs is not mentioned in any guidebooks. And it seems to us, certainly our listening audience, you know, these are people, these are travelers who seek authentic experiences. And it seems that the street would offer a traveler the most authentic Parisian experience. Why do you think the Rue des Martyrs has been overlooked?
It's not in guidebooks for a number of reasons. I mean, for, you know, 50 years ago, there were more prostitutes than children on the Rue des Martyrs. Mm-hmm. You know, it was a very rough neighborhood. In the 19th century, when it was first developed, when Paris was expanding rapidly after industrialization, and the buildings there are not grand buildings that you might see in some of the other neighborhoods. They're simpler. They're not very architecturally interesting. There are no museums on the Rue des Martyrs. It's sort of, if you go straight up the Rue des Martyrs to the end and you keep walking north, you'll hit Montmartre, so you'll hit Sacré-Cœur. But it has not been on the radar screen of tourists. And that made it even more wonderful for me because there were no Americans on the street. None of my neighbors speak English. And this was one reason why I felt so delighted to be made to feel at home. Now, this may all change with your radio program, because if you make me famous, then everybody's going to come to the Rue des Martyrs. So in a few years, there might be a St. Ignatius tapas bar or gift shop.